group is complete, of this group, CIO group, without their views on markets, interest rates, etc., that is customary. After that, I'll come to the main questions. So I'll start with Gopal. Your views on the markets and interest rates, because if I don't ask you this question, you know, it will be like a meal unfinished.
So, thank you. First of all, on the market side, I would say we are definitely on a growth path. And what history has said, whenever the earnings bottom and the growth rate is on upward trajectory, market trajectory looks very positive. So I think after the 4 years of, you know, flat earning growth, now we are really bottom. So earnings looks positive for FY17 and onward. And also GDP growth rate is on upward trajectory. So both makes the case for a better time in the market. And I expect this rally, you know, to become more broad-based than what we had seen in the last 3-4 years. On the interest rate side, I have a view that not more than 25 basis rate cut is possible in the next 6 to 9 months. Because whatever the monsoon can be good, but what we are seeing, some of the agri commodities, which were at a very low level in the last 3 years, have moved up by 30% to 50%, which has a very meaningful weightage in our inflation basket. So despite the monsoon can be good, we cannot have a very lower CPI. So I expect max to max 25 basis points rate cut in 6 to 9 months. Thank you.
Prashant?
No, I think I agree with Gopal, and that we have had 8 years of nearly flat markets. So Jan 2008 and today, the index is up only 20%. If you look at the market cap to GDP of India, it is now near the bottom of the Lehman crisis. So earnings are still not there, but profitability is again at a cyclical bottom. I think next few years we should see a strong mean reversion in profitability. And there are ample signs in last quarter numbers. So I'm quite optimistic. I also feel that these markets are in transition. And last 5-7 years, we have seen very high inflation, very weak capex, and a sharp currency depreciation. I think going forward, we should see low inflation, notwithstanding some increase in agricultural prices. But these are very short-term variations. A good monsoon, vegetable crops are very short-cycle crops. So I think generally we should have lower inflation. We should have stable currency. Current account is now less than net FDI in the country for the first time in many, many decades. And I think there are reasonable signs of recovery in capex. So I feel that these markets are in transition, and what has worked well for the last 5-7 years may not work well, and the converse should again happen. Thank you.
Nalin, your short views.
I think 2 years from now, earnings should be better. I think capex should have revived. So given that framework, I think clearly markets look good with a two to three year view. Having said that, one should not forget that finally all markets move up due to what global central banks do. So in the last 4 months, the global central banks have basically worked hard to create this rally across all the markets by the US Fed saying that I don't want to increase rates, so ensuring dollar doesn't go up. The Japanese central bank and the European central bank not pursuing negative interest rates and pushing their currencies down. So I think the way the global backdrop is that they don't want to have a market fall. They don't want to have even a big correction. So the global central banks are there to backstop the market as and when it falls. So also it means that if markets keep going up, they will have to do something to create some ammunition. And that ammunition can create volatility. So while the two-year outlook is good, but I think there will be intermittent periods where you'll have a fair amount of volatility. On debt, I think the reality is that the entire Indian industry has hardly invested in debt other than tax-free bond, at least in the mutual fund industry. So I think from an asset allocation perspective, they still seem to be long real estate and short fixed income. And therefore, while I agree with Gopal that there may not be many rate cuts, I think it's an underinvested asset class, which proved its value last year. I think if we believe that, you know, there has to be, like we have seen a fair amount of credit growth, if you believe in crude oil going to 100, 110, I don't think fixed income is the way to go. I think fixed income deserves a allocation, and I find that most investors I meet have no allocation except for the people who have invested in tax-free bond 2 years back. So I believe that yes, the bigger returns or the very big returns are through with the last 2 years, but there should be an allocation. Should that allocation be through investing in hybrid funds? Maybe that may be the way to invest in debt at this point of time.
Thanks, Narendra. I'll go now the reverse way. Narendra, one of the issues as a distributor, as an advisor we have is that, you know, instead of stock picking, which is a direct equity method, we have to also look at the portfolio of the client. Now from the fund management perspective also, you have to construct a portfolio, not necessarily just pick up a stock. Picking up a stock is one step to the portfolio. From your experience, what have been the best practices of making a holistic portfolio? So what are the do's and don'ts of making a portfolio? Because essentially as an advisor, as I said, you know, this is really our responsibility towards our clients.
I think one is that basically you have to decide whether you are believing in a big bearish market or in a big bullish market. And so that automatically makes certain decisions very clear. Suppose you are a believer in moderate returns, then you have a set of sectors like consumer or pharmaceutical or technology or utilities kind of sectors to be a good part of the portfolio. On the other hand, if you are negative on the markets, very positive in the markets, clearly there's a role for small cap, mid cap in the portfolio. So I think portfolio construction, ideally I would like to do basically a situation where look at where there has been a fair amount of underperformance over a long period of time and where I trust the companies to actually do well over a period of time. And I think the real portfolio construction phases, the difficult phases for a fund manager has been in big bull markets like 1999 and 2007, where you had clear portfolio choices, like in 1999 to avoid maybe TMT, or in 2007 to avoid infra. But in those years, to actually create a portfolio without infra, or a portfolio in 99 without IT, would have been very difficult. So I think the right portfolio choices is respect valuations, respect cycle, respect where there is a bubble, and invest. That would be ideal. But during those periods when I keep worrying about bubbles and busts, because in those bubbles is when I think the toughest part of our job comes in. Similarly, in big busts also, a tough part happens. And over the last 6-7 years, we have neither had a bubble nor a bust, except maybe in real estate. So it's made our job pretty easy. But portfolio construction is difficult during bubbles and busts. Periods like now are much easier at this point of time to construct portfolios.
So Prashant, suppose, you know, we were to take sort of two clusters of clients, customers. One who are clearly towards growth. You know, young people, they must make the money work harder. And then you have, let's say, near retirement where it is more moderate. Capital preservation is also one of the big drivers of the portfolio. In that, you know, is it a sectoral play or is it just, you know, different kind of funds are created for these two different kind of customers? And in that, what would you say is the way to play interest rates? You know, is it fixed income, because at the end of it, tax-free gives an absolute return, which can't be said about when you play a duration, because it's not absolute return, you know, it depends on that time of exit. So how do you play this portfolio part for, let's say, two different personas of customers?
See, what I have experienced in my opinion, I mean, age is certainly a very important factor in deciding this, but I think if you answer two questions right, it does most of the job. And it is simply what portion of your wealth can one spare for 3-5 year periods. You may be 80 years of age or you may be 25 years of age. If I have to buy a house, I actually can't take much of risk. And if I am 80 and I have a lot of surplus money, I can still take volatility. So what is that portion of one's wealth which is spared, can be spared for 3-5 years? And on what portion of one's wealth can one take 10-15-20% temporary downside? I think whatever the answer to these questions, that the right asset allocation towards equities and the balance should be in fixed income. And fixed income, whatever it offers, we have to accept, because equity is the key decision. I mean, that's my risk capital. And whatever is balance comes to fixed income. And whether interest rates are 5 or 8%, I think that is secondary. I think, I mean, it's not so much about sectors or specific funds. Asset allocation is the key. And there have been few studies which have kind of, which suggest that asset allocation delivers 90% or more of long-term returns.
Absolutely.
And security selection actually plays a relatively minor role. And one final point is, when, I mean, it has been experienced, and I think most people will agree with this, that when the majority gets down to selecting funds, I mean, particularly thematic funds, they simply chase last 3 years' performance. So IT funds were the most popular in 99, and infra funds were the most popular in 2007. So I think if one is genuinely not, one genuinely does not understand equities, it is simply, to my mind, good to go for diversified equity funds.
Gopal, between large cap and mid cap, one can be argued, and data at least suggests, that in general, mid cap, the alpha generated has been more than in the large cap. And reasons are not sort of far to believe, because at the end of it, I think stock selection, because they are under researched, you know, you can discover them better, etc., etc. So would you say that within equity, suppose we take equity as an asset class at this point of time, how would you mix large cap and mid cap? What I'm hearing is that thematic is something that one should not jump into, is what I'm hearing. Because they seem to be flavor of the month, flavor of the season, and you don't know when to exit. And that is the real issue. So how would you divide it between large cap and mid cap, and how would you play? Because for a small investor, for a small client, they can actually allocate a large amount to mid cap and large cap as well.
See, first of all, for our perspective, a stock is a stock, whether it is a mid cap or large cap. Honestly speaking, because the portfolio construction is generally is being done on the merit of the business. Okay, that is first thing. So definitely with the size of the fund, you know, your choice differs to buy a large cap or mid cap. Okay, so until and unless if you don't have that restrictions with you, so we should choose the stocks based on the merit. Okay, but as the fund size grows up, so you have a problem of liquidity, so you tend to go more towards the large cap.
Gopal, but as a client,
yes.
You know, I have a choice of putting money in large cap. I have a choice of putting money in mid cap. Now, the alpha generated, data shows, alpha generated in mid cap is more than the alpha generated in large cap. And it is also because perhaps it is tougher to make more money in large cap because it is, over-researched. Many people already there, liquidity is already there, etc., etc. So the information asymmetry is more in mid cap as in large cap. So as an investor, you think if one wants growth, one should put more in mid cap, or as you age and as you said that you cannot take that much of a risk, it is lesser volatile, one should move more towards large cap?
See, first of all, I would generally say, you know, the mid caps tends to do well when you are in a falling interest rate environment. Okay, right? Because most of the mid-cap companies, you know, have a problem of borrowing at a reasonable price, reasonable cost of interest, and they tend to benefit in a falling interest rate environment. And also they get benefit because the government expenditure during that period is generally much better. Okay, because what is the interest rate is definitely your requirement of forex, right? So if the interest rate is coming down, means the government of India's finances are better, and then they tend to spend more. So the wheel of the economy is running faster. So in this scenario, generally the mid cap tends to do better. And my sense is that during that period, the allocation towards mid-cap should be more than the large-cap and the vice versa.